I'm so happy to greet you because I'm, I think, one of the few leaders of the Coalition of Electing that have never attacked you and do not intend to. And we're so happy to have you as our president. And I want to do everything I can to see you, that you are reelected and everybody else who supports you.
Well, bless you. I was going to say to you that you have not wavered.
You've never seen me in any of those groups of people attacking you. And I know you're pressed for time, and so I brought along a little memo to say what I have to say, because we want to work for your reelection and the election of all good Republicans. And I think we did a lot of good work with the nuclear freeze referendum recently. And we're going to continue to work on that, especially with women. But I want to help you get rid of this ERA problem and make it go away. And so page one are some of my notes, but if you turn over to page two, what I want to offer to you is not a strategy for defeating ERA, because I think it's already been defeated. And we have proved that your position was right and that the states and the people don't want it. But it is a strategy against Republicans. It is basically today something to hit Republicans with. And their purpose is to defeat Republicans. They want to use it as a fundraising mechanism, and they want to keep us busy playing on their ball field instead of doing constructive things like working on your agenda. So I feel that there are several things we should not do. We should not let the Democratic leadership dictate the timing and the agenda and fight over the old battles and play by their rules. And I think that if the administration does nothing, we are acceding to their timing and their rules. So over on the next page, I want to help you recapture the initiative, that is, avoid being the whipping boy of the Tip O'Neills. And therefore, I would propose that you might send a letter to Bob Michael urging that ERA, if it's considered by the House, be used as a constitutional vehicle to force consideration of the amendments that you want and that the people have asked for. And without mentioning ERA, I don't want to involve you in the ERA battle, you raise the specter of Republicans offering as amendments to ERA your amendments, the school prayer amendment, a busing amendment, a right to life amendment, a prayer amendment. And therefore, you send the Democrats a clear signal that if they force ERA to a vote, that they're also going to have to deal with all these other issues on your agenda. And it is a way for you to redefine the issue in your terms, which is the term of basic fairness. The argument is, ERA had 10 years and two chances considering the unfair extension. And the people have never had a chance to vote on the school prayer amendment, which we've been wanting to vote on for 20 years since the Supreme Court decision, or a right to life amendment, which we've been wanting for 10 years, or a balanced budget amendment. And Tip O'Neill has to understand that if he's going to force an ERA vote, he's also going to have to vote on these other issues too. The way he plays with the rules, the only way we have to force the other constitutional amendments in the House is to play with them on a constitutional amendment. And in other words, they've tossed us a lemon, we're going to make lemonade out of it. And now.
We can wheel it over there again.
Oh, well, all right, no, I'll switch seats.
Trip and get a, yep, I'll stay sitting.
I wouldn't like to get them. I don't know when they're going to call back or if. Yes.
I asked to see you about two topics.
Oh, God.
That's fine.
We have a photo op.
Anyone want to place any cool bets on your sample last
question? I must say it was he did the same thing that he always does at that lunch with the
Oh.
We got a Oregon, Oregon wilderness bill up there that's very important to Oregon season. They're having a series of votes. That's on how they're missing.
Guys, on this side, it's all I have to worry about.
Actually, the rating committee had a little beauty search here and put the good looking fellows on this side.
Shows what trouble we're in.
That's right.
Lights, please. Thank you.
Well, I won't waste any time talking about the first day of spring or anything like that, except that I think our friends up there on the other side of the aisle have embarked on a last ditch effort to turn the clock back instead of, as we will shortly be doing, turning it forward. And I'm referring to their budget plan. The trend line, I think, goes right backward. I think all of us have some feeling that they have no intention of really getting that as a budget, but maybe laying the grounds for being able to woo their people by saying, here is a sample of traditional democracy or democratic policy. But you know, and I know, it throws everything out the window that we've achieved in these last 2 years, and now with the report that I just gave on the economy, and there are other signs that are just as promising, I think they picked the wrong timing for it. Their plan, as I understand it, calls for a $27 billion increase in taxes. This is just for the 1 year. A $10 billion cut in defense, $8 billion increase in the 2 year deficit, and all of this so they can wind up with a $45 billion increase in domestic spending over and above what we've proposed. And that's just the short run proposal. If you multiply those out into the 5 year projections, which I've already admitted I don't like, but it would raise taxes by $316 billion over 5 years. That would cancel 42% of the net tax cut that we've given to the American people. We've got the defense rebuilding program by slashing $206 billion from our request over the same period. Would repeal many of the overdue welfare reforms we've already enacted, throwing away billions of dollars in savings, and in name of fairness would add an incredible $181 billion. 5 years in domestic spending to the high levels already proposed. And they call that a fairness budget. Actually, I think it's cruelty to the taxpayers who face new huge burdens. To consumers who would be threatened again with inflation going up, and to the jobless who have no hope of economic recovery. And any peace-loving citizen would have to figure what it does to us with regard to our security. So, I think that this is when we go to the mat on. As I say, I think they're vulnerable. I've already talked to one group of your colleagues, and I'm going to be talking to more, but to talk to you about, I think they've given us really something to tee off on. Here is, they want a flat comparison of what their belief is and where they want to go, as in contrast to what we're trying to do. And a few months ago, it may have made more headway when things were looking as bad as they are, but with all the economic signs that we have, I think that we can stand back and say what we've been doing is beginning to work. And I just hope that we can mobilize not only all our forces, but get enough responsible thinking Democrats to join us in just flatly not trying to deal with this or bargain with it, but just flatly voted down as being the wrong direction to go. And I'll stop talking now and take it up there. That's in particular.
A university is something of that nature. Now, how do you put a value on what an author has written, on his works, and the like?
How have they been doing it?
Well, they haven't been able to give away the terrible picture. But people will go around and buy up somebody's manuscript or something of that nature and establish a fair amount of value that way. But if you give it
you run all right and write your memo, but then if you try to sell it in the open market, would somebody pay $1 million for it? But if you gave it to University of Southern California, let's say, you could declare it $1 million and get that off your taxes.
And that's not $1 million.
That's what I'm telling Doug.
He's scheduled, his schedule says he's going to come.
Yeah. Well, this is your economic briefing. It will consist of two parts. One for the year 1983, the calendar year. And then to get into the international situation, as far as what's going on with some of these less developed countries, and now the shift as to where the problem children are in the world economy, and what we may or may not be thinking of doing about it. So Marty's going to take you through the first part, and I'll take you through the second.
Well, at first, when we talked about this meeting, we thought we might talk about some more specific things like monetary policy or the international trade problem we face this year. We decided it would be better to come back to those at a subsequent time and focus on an overview of the last year. But as recently as 6 weeks ago, we had no clear evidence of an actual upturn in economic activity. And then by early February, we began to get the statistics for January. And we had employment going up, earnings going up, industrial production going up. We really saw a broad-based upturn in the economy, and I wrote to you at that time and said that I thought it was pretty clear that the same would be
slip around here.
Underway, and I don't want to remain a monologue. It's going to be a dialogue when we get going, but the subject of the meeting is the budget that was passed on a straight party line basis of the Democrats out of their committee. Their version of the budget, which they have declared, is a restatement of Democratic tradition, and I'm afraid it is. But I don't see any way that we can, with our own proposal of a budget, there could be any effort to compromise or find a meeting ground. This budget that has been proposed by them must be defeated. This proposal calls for increasing taxes over the next 5 years by about $315 billion. It calls for canceling most of the gains and the savings that we've made in entitlement programs and so forth over the last 2 years. It increases over that same period of time domestic spending by, I believe, Dave, I'm right, about $181 billion. Increasing that spending that much, increasing the taxes that much, it also will reduce the defense budget down to a point that is some $31 billion below the defense budget that had been planned by President Carter, and which we're trying to rectify and get our defenses to recover from. But when all that is done, they will have wound up with an $8 billion addition to the deficit for the years 83-84. In other words, all of this will be done to simply achieve tens of billions of dollars of new spending. As a matter of fact, they have introduced some 10 new social domestic programs, in addition to reducing or eliminating the savings that we've made. Now, the taxes that they're going to increase calls for canceling the third year of the income tax cut and canceling index. The truth of the matter is that in both of these taxes, the bulk of them, 72% of one, the third year cut, and 78% of the indexing, the savings there goes to people below the $50,000 mark. Middle income and lower middle income earners are the ones that will pay the bulk of that tax. obviously indexing is strictly for the working man and woman in this country, because they're the ones that, when they get a cost of living pay raise, are moved up into a higher tax bracket. Well, it can't be a benefit to the rich because they're already in the top bracket. And so you push them. And I just feel that this thing is such a throwback that we have to make it plain to the people what this would result in. This is going back to the type of government programs that caused the problems that we're facing today. But the main thing is we're in a recovery. There's no question about it. The word came out yesterday in regard to the growth in the gross national product. And to do things of this kind, the taxes would be almost $30 billion in the first year, the tax increase. That's no way to keep a recovery going. That is going to cut off recovery. And I make one last point, and then we will turn to this for conversation here and for more detail on this. But when we went for the tax increase that we did a year or so ago, and many of us, as we said then, had to swallow hard to do it, we did that on a kind of bipartisan agreement that we were going to get $3 in spending tax for every $1 of increase in taxes. And this is a complete repudiation of that agreement to now turn around and offer this kind of a proposal. So again, as I say, our job, I know we're outnumbered in the House, but our job is to find those Democrats that I'm sure are there who are responsible and who will go along with repudiating a proposal of this kind.
Vice President.
And the statement.
Thank you. Good.